Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And good morning to all of you watching us virtually. As I said to this lovely group last night, it's good to see you again, although I wish it wasn't so soon, and to all of you watching the same thing. But in this case, I wish it wasn't so soon, but I'm kind of glad it was. For you see, the call from the family for Otto was not supposed to be for Otto. It was supposed to be for Kit. She had been suffering, and I have yet to understand why God puts people through some of the physical manifestations. But that's what faith is about, and the fact that she died on Good Friday, I don't think, is an accident. The fact that she was with Otto and all those who've gone before on Easter Sunday, no accident. So although I am sad to see you again so soon, I'm grateful that we're all together virtually and in person to celebrate the life of this mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, sister, friend. As I said last time, for all of you watching, I hope that wherever you are, you put things down and just focus on being here and pretend you were sitting here with this family and just bring your mind and your heart and your just all to this time and this place. In a moment, we're going to do the transfer prayers that we did for Otto. Similar rite, a little different reading this time, but similar in the spirit. But first, because of our timing today, instead of doing the eulogy in church, we're going to do it here. And I've been honored and lucky enough to get a little pre-glimpse of it. And I would encourage you definitely to put down the bagel or the cup of coffee and focus, because it's very good. And yes, you are welcome to laugh, because the draft I read certainly had a few funny quips in it. And that's what this is about. It's not just about prayer and being. It's about the memories that infuse our hearts to make us smile and laugh. So I'm going to ask you to come forward to talk about your mom.
Mom was an avid reader, traveler, movie, museum, ballet, opera, Boston Pops, Broadway musical, play fan. She was part of a local bridge team, a churchgoer, horse racing fan, skier, and had a love for the arts and crafts. A pianist, seamstress, teacher, wife, mother, sister, daughter, and so much more. My mom was the eldest of four children. She is preceded in death by her parents, two siblings, her husband Otto, and two daughters, Carrie and Donna. She was a graduate of Lasell College in Massachusetts with a degree in business. My father would often say, "Mom can make $100 out of a penny." She was very business savvy. Mom also worked as a ward clerk at the Hunterdon Medical Center. You could often find my mother with Reverend Tex Colton giving last rites to a dying patient. Later, after she retired, she would donate her time to help out the local nurses by taking temperatures and blood pressure. My mom was Donna's, Gina's, Peter's, and my CCD teacher. In the beginning, it was like, "Mom is my CCD teacher? Oh no." But in the end, all we could say is, "Thank you, Mom. Great job." She would often stay after CCD to ensure every child was picked up. If not, we would always have another child to bring home. Mom was always willing to help others in need. I remember a friend of mine and her husband was struggling financially, for my friend had no furniture for her bed. Without a thought, my mom donated beds, mattresses, pillows, blankets, bedspreads, and so much more. By nightfall, her children had nice beds to sleep in. To this day, my friend calls my mom a great lady. If you look closely at all her children, she must have done something right, for there is not a child who's not helped out someone in need, whether it be helping to feed a family of five, helping out in soup kitchens, donating furniture, overturning legislative bills to keep our environment safe and clean for future generations, to donating for so many worthwhile other causes. You could find my mother cutting out coupons to feed a children of eight, plus one more. I don't know how she did things. Taking care of eight children would drive me nuts. So one day, I asked my mom, after much thought, would you have us all over again? And without missing a beat, my mom said, yes, she would have each and every one of us all over again. She might do things differently, but yeah, absolutely yes. The stories. My mom had a love for Christmas, and she lived for it. Sometimes we thought our mother got more into the Christmas spirit than we did, especially as we grew older. Christmas usually started with my mom getting the Sears and Roebuck catalog. And with that catalog, the Christmas music started. How we, as children, used to pore over that catalog endlessly. By Thanksgiving, that catalog had so many creases, wrinkles, and dog ears. We did not get much, so we learned how to share. We did not receive, but what we received with love. Mom and Dad liked to see us to the Macy's Day Parade. That was often followed by visiting our grandparents, only to return to New York City to see all the Christmas lights and decorations. Later on, as we grew older, Mom would still go to the Macy's Day Parade. According to Gina, Mom adored Kermit the Frog, which culminated in Mom going back to the parade to see Kermit as Grand Marshal. At another point, we went to see the Radio City Christmas show with the Rockettes. I believe Kathy was dating Mark at the time. When the Rockettes came on, you could see my mom and my sister Kathy nudging their significant others, to which both Mark and Dad replied to Mom and Kathy, we are just watching the show. The rest of us laughed among the surrounding disapproving looks. Some moms are cooks. Our mom was a baker. Mom had a sweet tooth. In addition to the specialty birthday desserts, there was the cookies. We are talking major cookie bacon. As we brought in our cookies for lunch, Donna, who is now deceased, and I were talking and remembering how envious our classmates were. Donna, in her humorous way, said, we should have sold those cookies for a dollar. We would have made out like bandits. Oh, and by the way, let's not forget the apple tapple and all the other desserts. And I believe my sister Kathy would have joined Mom later on. Then there was a Christmas tree incident. One of my siblings, who shall remain nameless, threw the decorations were gorgeous, so gorgeous that the entire tree was pulled down, make a huge resounding crash. My father came running from the back room, demanding to know what happened. My mother patiently told him everything, and then said, Otto, do not worry. The tree will be back up in 5 minutes. And it was, amidst the laughter of all the kids. Ricky added this one on. I believe this was a recurring theme. You know, the Christmas tree crashing? I remember when we were dating, getting a call from Diane late at night, getting me out of bed, saying, the Christmas tree came crashing down. And now Kit was wildly swinging a hammer to get it fixed. I think it was a problem with the tree stand. And then Ricky went back to bed. Our Christmas ornaments were usually handmade of highly decorated styrofoam balls, colored plaster of Paris figurines, and crutch sets, just to name a few. Later, the tree would be replaced by acorn trees, ceramic, sketching classes, and so much more. Often I would find myself making crafts until Mom cannot use her hands anymore because they became so unbearable to use. When we were young, my father got a job at the University of Oregon. Mom, who loved to travel, packed up our belongings, and we proceeded to travel across the country in a non-air-conditioned car with voices repeatedly saying, "Are we there yet?" Later on in life, Mom and Dad would make that trip again, and they would do it in remembering about the trip she made with us for not so long ago. As I mentioned, Mom loved Broadway and anything to do with Broadway, whether it be plays, musicals, or movies. When Barbara lived in New York City, Mom would often bring Donna and Peter to see Barbara, then go to see a musical or a play or a movie. Together, they saw the movie Airplane, an iconic classic comedy. By the time the movie ended, they were all laughing and having a great time. So next time, I decided to go in with some of the same crew. Olivia Newton-John had just starred in Grease, inspiring us all to see the next movie, Xanadu. Within 5 minutes, we were begging our mom to leave. We told her that we deserved our money back. I believe I fell asleep, but unfortunately, Donna and Barbara did not. They stayed awake for an hour and a half with Mom. When the movie was over, my mom said with a deadpan face, "That was the worst movie I ever saw." That gave us a laugh. Mom would often go to see Broadway plays and musicals with Dad and family. Like Gina, Mom adored Hugh Jackman and also shared many laughs together. At that point, I didn't even know who Hugh Jackman was. It wasn't until later. Mom was a ski bunny. Age was not a requirement. When most people retire from downhill, Mom just got started, and I believe she was in her 50s and 60s at this time. Mom was fearless on those slopes. Just ask family who went with her. Okay. Mom loved her family so much, the following statements could be made. After visiting China, she came home and requested Eugenia and Rodney that she would like a granddaughter from China. What mom didn't know, in addition to the two adopted children from Honduras, Gina and Rodney had already processed the paperwork for one girl from China, and that would be followed up by another girl from China. It was also said to Peter and I at different times how happy they were to have an extended family. So thank you, Karen, Patricia, Mark, Rodney, Ed, and Ricky, for being great daughter-in-laws and son-in-laws. Mom was fairly inclusive and fairly open to different ways of life. As Mom put it, no one child was more important than the other. It did not matter what the degree was. The same went for the grandchildren. They were really adamant about this. Mom was an avid reader. She loved poetry, art books, the classics, and so much more. Her father instilled in her the love of a good book. Mom, in turn, instilled the same in us by visiting the weekly bookmobile. Later on, she would give her grandchildren a couple of books and a savings bond for birthdays and holidays. By the time they reached college, they had a tiny nest egg to buy college books. With her grandchildren, it was always a book, followed by, "Where are you going to college? When are you going to college? What are you going to study in?" Education was very important to Grandma and Grandpa, said Jordan and Jared. Every child and grandchild would have a degree. All their children have a degree, 2 in business, 4 in science, and 1 in home economics, and all the grandchildren's degrees are too many to mention. Some of our most fond memories of Grandma and Grandpa is when they took us to Manhattan, whether to see our first Broadway play, the Philharmonic, or the New York City Ballet. Their love and appreciation of the arts was instilled in us, and it is something we will always cherish. They also had a passion for history and culture, and they utilized the knowledge at every opportunity. Even though we were young and didn't fully comprehend at the time, they felt it was important that they passed it on to us. We will never forget those holiday dinners when Grandma would holler at us to keep our elbows off the table. She would always say, "We are eating in a five-star restaurant." We would roll our eyes. But that was the quintessential Grandma Kit. We always love her and miss her. And I'm pretty sure every grandchild would say that. On my mom's last day, I took out my cell phone and phoned the majority of my siblings who had not said goodbye yet. When each and everyone said goodbye, I put on music and I started to play all different songs from Broadway plays, music, and musicals, anything I could think of to represent all of us. The very last song I played for Mom was a Christian Chenoweth tune. "Because I Knew You, Because I Knew You, I Have Been Changed for Good." And then she passed away. So thank you, Mom, Grandma, sister, and friend. Thank you for all the dear memories we'll hold dear to our heart. For life, love, laughter, family, and so much more. You will be sorely missed by all. Love you, Mom, Grandma, sister, friend, now and forever. And Mom, it's because we knew you. Because we knew you. We have been changed for good.
Thank you, Diane. I'm young enough. I remember this year's Roebuck catalog, too. Y'all, you don't even know what a Sears Roebuck catalog is. Sears, that was that store that you guys used to shop in when we were, like, real little. What's a catalog? Kidding. With the creases, yep. I remember very well. Thank you. Let us begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We hear from Romans. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. Dear friends, our Lord comes to raise the dead and comforts us with the solace of his love. Let us praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Let your response to the following petitions be, "Lord, have mercy." Word of God, creator of the earth, to which Kathleen now returns, in baptism you called her to eternal life to praise your Father forever. Lord, have mercy. Lord. Son of God, you raise up the just and clothe them with the glory of your kingdom. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Crucified Lord, you protect the soul of Kathleen by the power of your cross, and on the day of your coming will show mercy to all the faithful departed. Lord, have mercy. Judge of the living and of the dead, at your voice the tombs will open, and all the just who sleep in your peace will rise and sing the glory of God. Lord, have mercy. All praise to you, Jesus our Savior. Death is in your hands, and all the living depend on you alone. Lord, have mercy. You may remember for your father, I read the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. I selected a different reading, somewhat based a little bit on the fact that Mom died on Good Friday. It's a reading from John 11, regarding more so resurrection. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise. Martha said to him, I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I selected that because as Deacon Stephen said, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, Easter Sunday. The time of the year when we remember that gospel very intently. Because how can we not? It's resurrection, resurrection, resurrection. But why do we not think about that all year round? Right? There's a lot of other stuff to read. I get it. But those specific words are what your mother and father instilled in all of you. And they're what gives your faith the strength to withstand anything, especially death, which most of us would say is one of the worst things that could happen in life. That we lose somebody we love, although I challenge that you did not lose anybody, and I said this about Otto. You know very well where he is, and you know you'll see him again. Not for a long time, we hope. But your faith gives you the ability to deal with anything that the good Lord lets come in our path. Yes, sometimes we wonder why, as I said before, why did Kit specifically have to go through that long illness where we saw her body change from that woman who could hold three of you up at once to where you had to hold her? I don't know. I'm not here to answer that. The promise is the promise. The promise is what's given. Just believe and have hope. As I said the last time, and Deacon Stephen reiterated, and him and I did not compare notes, all these readings about death, all the prayers, you'll hear hope, that word interjected in a lot of... I always wonder when they wrote the good book, did somebody want to remind us during our most downtrodden times that hope is eternal? Hope springs forth. So as we go about today especially, and as you leave this place, and I know sadly I will not see some of you again. I hope if you're around in New York, you call me. We'll go see Broadway. Not anything to do with Xanadu, though. But wherever you go, keep hope in your heart. Keep the knowledge and love of the promises, and let that strengthen you. Until that day, we all are reunited in that place where there's no pain, no suffering, but only light, peace, and hope. Now, with faith and hope, let us turn together and join in the words that Jesus gave his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. And let us ask for the intercession of the Blessed Mother. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Lord, Kathleen is now gone from this earthly dwelling and has left behind those who mourn her absence. Grant that as we grieve for our beloved sister, we may hold her memory dear and live in hope of the eternal kingdom where you will bring us together again. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord guards our coming in and our going out. May God be with us as we make this final journey with our sister. We hear, I rejoice when I heard them say, let us go to the house of the Lord. I rejoice because they said to me, we will go to the house of the Lord. And now we have set foot within your gates, O Jerusalem. To the tribes go up, and the tribes of the Lord, according to the decree of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. In it are set up judgment seats, seats for the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you prosper. May peace be within your walls, prosperity in your buildings. Because of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be with you. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will pray for your good. I rejoiced when I heard them say, let us go to the house of the Lord. In a moment, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask you all to come forward. We're going to start from the back, and we'll call you row by row. You can pay your respects to the casket, after which you can just wait in the rooms behind this one while we prepare the casket, and then we'll give you instructions to follow us out to the hearse. At that point, I would ask you to drive with your high-beam headlights and four-way flasher lights. When we get to the church, only the first two or three cars behind the hearse will be allowed to come around the circle due to fire regulations. Everybody else, just park in the main parking lot. My staff will be there to guide you. Turn off your headlights and four-way flasher lights. And then when we get, we're going to ask you to come right into the narthex, and you'll be seated by the Lazarus Ministries. Again, we have to keep everybody separate and moved all over the place. So if you see some of your friends and you want to sit there, just let them know, and you can sit wherever you want. The church is very large, but we do need you to kind of socially distant and use hand sanitizer and keep your masks on and all the things that I know you will certainly do. All right. The crucifix that has been placed on Kathleen's pillow is the one that will be buried with her. You're certainly welcome to give that or touch her a kiss. You'll have that opportunity at the cemetery, but in case some of you aren't able to accompany us there, I want you to have that opportunity now. So I would ask that you remain in a state of reverent silence, and we'll be calling you up in just a moment.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Kit died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him in eternal glory. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Kathleen, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
We may all be seated now as we prepare for the liturgy of the word. Thanks be to God.
He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, How will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? No. In all of these things, we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God that comes to us in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I thirst." There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. but one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you may also come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took the body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. So first, I want to express my condolence on behalf of Father Briganti, the pastor here, on my own behalf, and the Lazarus ministry and everybody at the parish, to the family of Kit, family and friends. Just know that she'll continue to be in our thoughts and in our prayers even beyond this Mass. The Gospel we read for today's funeral Mass for Kit was the passion and death and burial of Jesus Christ, right? Our Lord who died on Good Friday, and here we have, Kit has something in eternity that she will always have with our Lord, is that she herself died on the same day that our Lord died, on Good Friday. Right. And right now, as we look around the church, we see, right, we're in the midst of Easter, right, celebrating the resurrection of Jesus, right, and so all of the statues were veiled before, now they're no longer veiled. We see all the beautiful statues, we see all the beautiful flowers, right, so it's a time in the church of celebration, right, time of rejoicing, and so there is a sense in which just the physical layout of the church can kind of seem to not match, right, with what we might feel inside right now. We certainly feel the loss of Kit, somebody who you love so dearly, you had such a strong relationship with, right? She's no longer physically with us anymore, right? It's very similar to how the disciples must have felt, how our Blessed Virgin Mary must have felt on that good Friday, right? That the Lord is no longer with us. And so there's a sense of loss that comes. But I think we can look deeply into the death of Kit and see how many graces she was given, right? As I just mentioned, she was given the grace of dying on Good Friday, right, when our Lord Jesus Christ died, to be able to unite with him in that moment of in that day in which he died in order to redeem us all. That's a real gift that she was given. Also, she was given what can be called, right, a happy death. Right? Saint Joseph is the patron saint of a happy death. And right now we're in the midst of the year of Saint Joseph, right? And so why is he called the patron saint of a happy death? Well, the traditional image of the death of Joseph is that the Blessed Virgin Mary, on the deathbed of St. Joseph, was at St. Joseph's side, consoling him. And the Lord Jesus was at his head, praying over him and anointing him with oil. Thanks be to God, I had the opportunity of anointing Kit a couple hours before she died, before the hour of mercy, around the 2 o'clock hour. I stayed with her for a little bit, and then I was able to give her the anointing of the sick. I was able to give her the last rites, was able to give her the apostolic pardon, which forgave her of all her temporal punishments in this world. And I was able to pray the prayers of the church, which are very beautiful on one's deathbed, that really commends the soul over to our Lord Jesus, commends the soul over to the angels and the saints. So she was able to receive the sacraments of the church before she passed away. And then, of course, many of you were able to be there, right? And so she was able to die next to those who loved her, right? And not only that, right, but many of you were here, it was about a month ago or a month and a half ago, right, when her husband Otto of 67 years passed away. Right? So she's given the gift now of the last, or the first thing, really, or one of the first things she's able to see in passing is to be able to see our Lord, right, all the angels and all the saints, but also her beloved husband Otto, right? She was able to see him in glory. So when we look at her death, right, in many ways, she experienced all the joy. Right? She's the one that got to receive so many gifts from our Lord, so many gifts that some of them, right, we might say she merited by the beautiful life that she lived, the life that you were able to experience, but also something that goes way beyond anything that we can hope to receive, right? It really shows how the Lord desires to lavish his gifts upon us. And so in many ways, right, she is experiencing Easter now, right? As we experience the season of Easter, she experiences the Easter as we experience that Good Friday, right? We experience that Good Friday. We experience that loss, not feeling or not having the presence of Kit with us. Right? But just as the Blessed Virgin Mary, just as St. John, they mourn the loss of their Lord, right? They mourn the loss of Christ on Good Friday. They always had the hope, right? They always had hope that they would see the Lord Jesus in a few days. They always had the hope that he would rise from the dead. And so while we might feel a certain loss, and it's good to feel lost, right? It's good to feel that sadness, to share those stories of your time with Kit, right? All those beautiful stories, and to feel the loss that she's no longer with us anymore. We don't mourn as those with no hope, right? We mourn and we grieve as those with hope and eternal life. And so we continue our prayer for Kit, and we continue our prayer for Otto, right? That we will see them one day with the angels and with the saints. Right? They stuck close to our Lord, Otto and Kit, within this world. And so we have the hope that they are plunged into the mercy of the Lord and that they experience what we're all meant to experience, right? Which is namely that beatific vision, that vision of God within paradise. And so they can also be an image to us of what we're called to. Right, that we're not meant for just this world. Sometimes, even at Catholic funerals, we focus too much on this world, right? Right? It's good, we need to share the beautiful memories of Kit's life. Right? We need to be able to recognize the goodness that they left behind, but the reality is that this life is so short and eternity is forever. And so, when we come to a funeral, we should also be reminded that we're not meant for this world. This is something that Kit knew. This is something that Otto knew. They knew that they were not meant for this world. And so now we pray so that the Lord is lavishing his love, lavishing his mercy upon them, that they are experiencing that Easter joy, that, right, that they are experiencing the Lord in his full glory as they await their resurrected bodies, as they await the last day when all will be right with the world. And that they will be with the Lord in their own bodies, in their glorified bodies, just as the Lord is in paradise in his glorified body. Right? So let's grieve, right? Let's be sad. But let's not let that sadness end with hopeless sadness, right? But let it be open to that joy, open to that hope of eternal life, that the cross of Jesus Christ turns into the resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? That our cross and all of our crosses lead to that resurrection of our Lord when we unite them with our Lord. And so we continue our prayer for Kit, and we continue our prayer for Otto. that we may see them with the Lord in paradise. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. May their souls and all the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Please stand. God the Almighty Father raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all his people, living and dead. And please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. For Kit, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that she may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For our sister Kit, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that she may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord. For our deceased relatives and friends and all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord. For the family and friends of our sister Kit, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord. And for all of us here assembled in faith to worship, that we may be gathered together in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord. God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. We may all be seated now as we prepare for the liturgy of the Eucharist. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant Kathleen may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape death from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we all might live forever. And so in the company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and James, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Kit, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Please stand. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
You take away the sins of the world. Have mercy. Lamb of God, of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. We will have one communion station at the kneeler to my right. For those Catholics who are in a state to receive communion, you can come up. I'll have my mask on, so you could place your mask down. I just ask that if you're receiving, you receive in front of me and not take the host back to the pew with you. If you will not be receiving today, for whatever reason, if you're non-Catholic or you're not in a place where you're ready to receive, if you would like, you can come up for a blessing. Just put your hands in an X formation, and I'll give you a blessing. You can also just stay in your pew if you prefer that also. the body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
And Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. Body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. Body of Christ. The body of Christ. Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I give you communion first. The body of Christ. Body of Christ. Thanks, Mark. Thank you.
Let us pray.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant Kathleen, for whom we have celebrated this Paschal sacrament, may pass over to a dwelling place of light and peace, through Christ our Lord. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day, we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Kit, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for all the many blessings which you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our communion with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest.